Hi, my name is Justin Cyrus, and I'm the CEO and founder here at Lunar Outpost. And this is how to make a space truck.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running.
Today we're going to be talking about the interesting geopolitics of the moon, all the way from the Cold War era to today, where we have many other countries heading to the lunar surface. So in previous videos, we went over the space race, kind of what it was and how it unfolded. Today, we're going to be going into a little bit more detail. So just to get you caught back up to speed, how this kicked off back during the 1970s, 1960s and 1970s, the space race was a technological competition between the USSR and the United States of America. And frankly, the Soviets got off to a pretty hot start, starting with Sputnik, the first satellite to orbit Earth, to the first man in space, all the way to Lunokhod, which is the first rovers ever on the lunar surface. The Soviets had the lead. However, America spent a good amount of time, effort, and energy, and frankly, pulled off something absolutely amazing in getting the first humans on the surface of the moon during the Apollo missions.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
So that's where we kicked off. And it's accelerated today quite drastically because there's a lot of new players in the race. We not only got Japan and India, which have come on board recently landing things on the lunar surface, but we have many commercial providers from other nations as well. And our nation-state competitors, China and Russia, certainly haven't been sleeping at the wheel. They have been making great strides, and frankly, in a few areas have outpaced and outmatched U.S. technological innovation in this new space race. And so that brings us to where we're at today, which is a much different environment than where we were at during the Cold War era and the first space race. The new space race is defined by international collaboration. And what we learned during the Apollo era is if we are going to make space sustainable, we have to do so internationally. So the first examples of doing that at scale were the International Space Station throughout the 90s, 2000s, all the way through today. And we've built on that for both soft power purposes, for technological innovation, and to bring a large amount of our allies together working towards a common goal. And that today for the United States is called the Artemis Accords. So countries all the way from the US to Brazil, to England, to Australia, to Canada, many of our allies are included as part of the Artemis Accords, and that's going to allow us to make pretty monumental leaps in technology and pretty monumental leaps in terms of ability to execute this idea, this grand vision of the Artemis campaign at scale. And notably absent are China and Russia. So they're on the other side of this. They have their own geopolitical apparatus that they're leveraging for their version of the Artemis Accords. However, they're not to be underestimated. They are making significant progress in the fields of spacesuits, in the fields of on-orbit transportation, and in the fields of rocketry. However, the commercial industry, combined with NASA, so through public-private partnerships, are certainly doing an amazing job at making sure we are competitive in this new space race, bringing in our international partners, and leveraging the expertise and abilities of nations across the world to achieve this grand objective. No country can actually own another celestial body. That's very interesting because that does not cover commercial companies going and collecting resources and actually selling them back, whether it's to a nation state or to other commercial customers. Another interesting fact is international organizations have different understandings of what space law actually looks like. So a few European countries have gotten together. They aren't allowing space resources in their framework. However, countries like the United States, Luxembourg, and the UAE have put laws in place to allow companies that are located in their countries to go and collect and sell space resources and allow for that large-scale commercialization out in space. So when you're looking at the harshest environment that's known to man, which is space, there's a mutual understanding and camaraderie between international organizations and space agencies that if astronauts are stranded, they'll help each other out. And that's something that we don't always see here on Earth, but that collaboration is incredibly important especially as we start scaling that international collaboration to the peaceful uses of space and large-scale industrial practices as we move forward. So to talk a little bit more about which countries have actually been to the moon and what they were able to accomplish there, let's start with China. So China has had enormous progress over the last couple decades as part of their space program. So everything from their Chang'e lander missions to their U2 rovers, where they've been exploring areas that we've never been before as humanity, including the far side of the moon, which is a first, to actually bringing back samples from the moon, which is what they're doing now. They have made enormous strides and are starting to outpace some international competitors. India as well just had their first mission to the moon, which happened within the last year. It was really exciting. They had a lander rover combination and were successfully able to stream images and videos back from that mission. Japan had their SLIM mission and their moon sniper missions that have headed to the lunar surface or are heading there shortly. And many other countries are starting to get involved, whether it's at the sensor layer, the component layer, the subsystems, and sending their own pieces and parts to the lunar surface as well. Russia, of course, went to the moon during the Apollo era with the Lunokhod rovers. However, they have not been back since. They do have a pretty aggressive campaign in which they want to start making progress here soon with their space agency, Roscosmos. And a few of the smaller countries are hitting above their weight. So Luxembourg has plans to put some payloads and rovers on the moon here shortly. And the UAE has some pretty ambitious plans as well to start making an impact at scale as part of the Artemis Accords. There are a few others, including the Canadian Space Agency and the Australian Space Agency, that have announced missions. The Canadian Space Agency has announced their large mobility project, the Lunar Utility Vehicle, which is very similar to our lunar terrain vehicle in many ways. However, it's looking at potentially carrying larger pieces of the infrastructure. We'll talk about that more in a later episode when we start talking about the different types of space trucks that we're going to have available on the moon and on Mars. So now that we have a good understanding, a better understanding at least, of what's going on in the international marketplace, let's dive more into what the Artemis campaign is and what we're going to be accomplishing with our space truck on the lunar surface. Now, this is incredibly important because when we start talking about a space truck on the moon, first question we get is, what's it going to be doing? A critical piece of the Artemis campaign is permanence. This is not a flags and footprints mission. We're not just going there for 1 hour or 2 hours, gonna pick up some rocks and come back. We're establishing a sustainable presence out in space for the very first time as humanity, which we're extraordinarily excited about. And with the Artemis campaign, we have the elements and we have the tools necessary to make that a reality. So Artemis is a broad campaign that encompasses everything from launch providers and rockets. So you have your landing systems, you have your in-space transportation capabilities, you have the Deep Space Gateway, which is the next international space station around the moon, but you also have the Artemis Base Camp, which is an actual outpost on the surface of the moon. And when you start looking at all these pieces and parts of the architecture and all these supporting pieces of equipment and systems and subsystems that need to come together to make this a reality, you quickly realize that mobility is a critical aspect of the broader Artemis campaign. So we are working to provide that critical support to set up the habitats, that Artemis base camp we just talked about, and the supporting infrastructure around it. So the solar panels, the power systems, the communications, the direct back to Earth communications, but also your launch and landing pads, which is a pretty important aspect of landing and operating on other planetary bodies. Not a lot of people know this, but if you actually land on the lunar surface without a landing pad, you basically sandblast everything you have around you. Imagine being in 1/6 gravity and having this very abrasive, just imagine sharp, tiny little rocks that are cutting through your spacesuit because someone's trying to land next to you. Or imagine being a robotic system and having your lenses covered or these sharp particles cutting up your solar panels. That's what we want to avoid, and that's why we need a space truck to build out these pieces in the infrastructure to actually make that grand vision, the Artemis campaign, a reality. All that to say, it is a broad campaign with many different elements that need to work together in a cohesive manner to enable that sustainability, to enable that permanence, and to allow us as humanity to make that next great leap. So thank you for joining us here today. I hope you learned something new about the international collaboration, about the Artemis Accords. But one major takeaway we want you to have is the moon, and specifically the lunar south pole, is the key to unlocking our solar system and the rest of our universe. The fuel and the resources that are available at this location are going to be critical in allowing humanity to reach further out into the stars and establishing a sustainable presence. So thanks again for joining us. Make sure you like and subscribe, hit the notification bell, and we'll see you next time.